some more time to the expert who have better thing to say than just going to this kind of nonsense. And so after this program, after presentation, we do have a networking that has food and drink. And before we start, I would like to introduce our chair. Please, you want to come and say something?
Well, thank you very much, Mary. It's a fantastic program that you set up for MBAR and our members. We sell properties, and we can't sell properties unless they're built. So this is an incredible program for us. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I know that he had such a busy schedule today, but he really supports all this big program, and I appreciate it. So now I want to introduce you, Genevieve, my co-chair, to introduce our guest.
Hi there, you guys. I'm Genevieve Kincannon, as Mary said, and I'm so pleased that you all carved out some time to come and talk about the Builder Realtor Forum and what BOA is going to do for us. And I bet they can talk about their backgrounds and how amazing and impressive they are. I was looking through what their backgrounds are, and I was like, highlights of your career? This whole thing looks like a highlight. This is pretty cool. So thanks so much to Tim and Steve from BOA for coming out. Tim actually joined BOA in 2012 as the vice president, focusing on bringing the Loudoun and Fauquier County folks up to speed. He's actually taught industry professionals on how to be good at what they do. So that's a big thumbs up. We're really appreciative of that. He's been doing this for over 25 years. Yes. Longer than that, but yeah, that's, well, thank you for doing that and keeping people on their toes. He's the president and chairman of the board of the National Association of Remodeling Industry, or NARI, so that's another bonus to have someone with that accreditation here in our midst. He has actually also been featured in the Washington Post and other newspapers and magazines, and been an industry expert for Fox, so that's always great. And then very cool stuff, he was the lead project manager of construction for the Emmy Award-winning construction reality TV show Extreme Makeover Home Edition. I thought that was really fun. Can't wait to hear some goodies about that. He described his experience on the show as a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. So that was great. He has a BFA in design from James Madison University and a postgraduate studies from project manager from the Keller Graduate School of Business Management. And then we also have Steve Scholl from BOA also. He joined BOA in 2015 as the project lead focused on guiding clients in Vienna, Ogden, and Fairfax. So we have the guy that's out in Fauquier County, Loudoun, and then Steve who's in Vienna, Ogden, and Fairfax. Steve has a long history of success with both business owner and project managing, having spent the past 12 years as a senior project developer with residential design build firms. He's also been working very closely with realtors, so you want to get to know him. Knows how to build those relationships, and that's what we're here to learn about, how to actually work together so that we know how to actually function and integrate what we do with what they do and how to make that seamless relationship. That's actually the key point of what this forum panel is going to be about. Hopefully you'll be able to really spell that out for us. In Steve's spare time, he spends a lot of time in nature, which you're outside all day, I'm sure.
That's right.
You get more out of being in nature, and he's originally from Massachusetts. Well, we're so glad you're here. Let's give him a round of applause.
All right, thank you all for coming. I know that this is sort of the Builder Series, a series, right? And you had some. Did any of you go to the first one? So I think that was more like developer, kind of custom home, or no, production home, probably. And when you think about remodelers and realtors, it's sort of like, wait, remodelers remodel homes, and we don't get to sell them or buy them. I mean, the absolute difference is can't be more true. I mean, our best part, and Steve and I especially, kind of pride our realtor partners as our best resources for new leads. So here's a quick agenda. I just want to say one thing. I was the president of NARI in 2008, not right now. So. We're going to talk about some facts for BOA, or facts about BOA, the why the partnership works between realtors and remodelers, and then we'll sort of hit some key points on that. We'll start it with some extreme makeover stuff so you guys can kind of get a glimpse of what that was like. That's a whole presentation in itself. So I'll hit maybe 10 minutes of that, but if you guys have any questions after that, feel free to ask them. Some answers to frequently asked remodeling questions and processes, and this is what may be the crux of this presentation for you guys. We do a lot of these presentations for potential clients for us, and they've asked us questions over and over. We've literally been doing this for 5 years or so presentations. We've combined the best questions, and that's what we have answers for you. And these are questions that your potential clients will ask you, so it should be helpful.
Can I touch on that? Okay. What we're hoping to is to provide a little bit of knowledge. Hey, I got a friend in the room, too. Because, as you know, knowledge breeds confidence, and confidence breeds enthusiasm, and enthusiasm breeds sales, whether you're selling houses or selling a project to a client so that they can improve their home. So this little bit of knowledge hopefully will give you the confidence not to be a renovation expert, but to have a way to handle the answer or the question that you get of, you know, I really like this home, and nobody's ever seen the perfect home, right? You can have the house can be 99% there, and your buyer's going to say, you know, it's the right school pyramid, and I like the flat lot, and the neighborhood's great, and the commute is good, but, you know, you want to be able to handle that. But, and maybe that question is, you know, Jane, how much is it going to cost for me to replace the kitchen? You know, and I hope that I'll be able to give you an answer that gets you away from saying the wrong thing and throws you back to, well, why don't we have Steve give you a call or Tim give you a call? And you don't step on the sale, you act like an expert, and you act like you're connected to a really good company who's going to help you with that stuff. So hopefully we're going to give you some knowledge today that's going to help you with what you're doing.
We'll also do some cost value figure analysis. And that's, I'll wait till we get to that. And then a question and answer period, which a lot of times is sort of the crux of, you know, we get some really good questions and we hopefully have an answer for them. Real quick, BOA, what we do, we guide, or your guide through every step of the remodeling experience. Our clients hire us if they want a turnkey solution, meaning they want us to hire the design, the budgeting, the production, the selections, the permitting, everything sort of combined. They hire us. We're a design build firm. We do architecture and production under one roof. We do the team approach, it's called. We specialize in renovation and additions, ranging from master suites, whole house renovations. Especially around here, I don't know if anyone here specializes in condos. Does anyone sell a lot of condos? That has become a huge market for our McLean office. I run the Middleburg office for the company, but Steve's in McLean. And DC and sort of Crystal City, that area, has become a huge market for us. Pre-purchase consultations, as we'll get into this a little bit, but as we mentioned before, our best partners are realtors, and pre-purchase consultations have a lot to do with that.
So this is a good snapshot of how a very successful realtor uses the pre-purchase consultation. So Saturday afternoon, about 12:30, Lori M. Long and Foster calls me and says, Steve, thanks for picking up your phone. I'm in my car with two buyers. We're just leaving a house on Arnon Chapel Road in Great Falls. They love the house, they love the neighborhood, they love, but the basement is unfinished. And they have plans for that basement that include a bathroom, and there's no bathroom plumbed there. They'd like a walkout because their plan is to have a pool, etc. Can you help talk us through that? Now, I'm sitting there with my daughter, and I say, and I say, you know, here's how we, and I take her through it. This is how we do, this is how we handle that bathroom that you want to put in, and this is how we handle that egress window so you can have a bathroom, a bedroom in the basement, and this is how we create that walkthrough, walkout. Are there any other concerns you have that we can talk through? no, that's great, thank you. So then I get a text a couple minutes later from Lori that says, you're the man, we're on the way back to the office, they're signing, what is the term you folks used when you, what is it?
Yeah.
That's right, thank you. So they go back, then I get a call a week later on a Thursday afternoon, it's about 4 o'clock. Steve, is there any way you can meet us out at the property tomorrow, Friday? I said, yep, I have 7 a.m. open. Silence. Okay, we'll make it work. So I go get there at 7, walk them through the basement, and they get the question, and this is part of the knowledge stuff. The missus says, so Steve, how much does a basement cost for this house? Now it's a $1.4 million house in Great Falls. I said, well, I have to ask you, how much is a car? She said, what car? I said, what basement? Is it a Camry? Is it a Lexus? Or is it a Land Rover you pulled up in? Well, it's probably going to be a Land Rover. Okay, well, let's talk about the budgets for all three of those to make sure it's a Land Rover that what you want. This is the kind of things you need to be able to say as a realtor so you can get away and call both. 2 weeks later, I get a call, Steve, great news. We got through the negotiations and signed. So, you know, that was literally about an hour and 15 minutes of my time. Do you think Lori's a fan of me and of Boa? Yes, she is. And, you know, I hope you'll have a relationship, whether it's with Boa or somebody else. But that's very powerful. If you have, you know, a handyman type guy to help your sellers and a really top flight renovation company to help your buyers, and your pre-purchase, that will sell you at least one more home here, in my opinion. That's the feedback we're getting.
Yeah, I mean,
don't get me started talking to him. You won't get it back.
I see. So that's sort of the goal here, is to help you guys sell. It's not that you become partnering with remodels only, but if it's one or two more sales a year, that's a huge thing. I know whatever that works out for you, one or two more projects for me is huge. So that's hopefully what we'll do. How can a remodeler help? First of all, caution, remodelers are not all like, Steve has another story, and I'm going to talk before he talks real quick about this one. But, so when I was president of NARI in DC, Metro DC, we represented about 3% of the industry. So remodeling is a super scattered industry, and you hear the horror stories and everything else about construction, and remodeling especially, right? That's like, oh my God, my remodel went horrible. You have to make sure the remodelers you're partnering with can do these things. Good remodelers communicate the dream, and home buying is personal. I mean, there's all ROI, and we can discuss all those things that you guys sort of talk about. But when a buyer or a seller that wants to get rid of their house or sell their house, and a potential buyer comes in, if it's in the right neighborhood, the right school district, they love the house, that buys personal. And I can tell a quick story. So I just went purchasing a truck for my son, just turned 16, and I had a certain amount I was gonna spend, right? So I negotiated with my wife that I was gonna spend this amount, and that I really needed a truck too. But I went and purchased.
Tim bought himself a new truck, and his son uses it to get to school.
Exactly. That's kind of what happened. So I ended up leaving there with a truck and spent $10,000 more than I wanted to spend. Or I thought I wanted to spend, but this guy kind of educated me. I know it's easy to sell to a salesman, so all of that stuff, regardless. I really didn't know that when I kind of thought about it afterwards, that's what I really wanted to buy. I mean, it made no sense to buy what I was planning to buy. So a good remodeler can communicate that dream to your client. Remodelers can help with cost analysis for future work. These purchase consultations, Steve and I do two a week at least with my realtor partners in Middleburg. And a lot of them are historic houses. They almost all need work. So and these are usually on a large scale dollar-wise. So my realtor partners call me, hey, can you meet with this client? They're not going to call me if I'm fumbling through what can be done. And oh geez, I don't know. I mean, if you pick the wrong remodeler to bring with you, it can be a disaster as far as the sale goes. It builds value with your clients when a professional remodeler joins you. I mean, that's just what it comes down to. It's better for your business. And then expert analysis of complex issues, building science, etc. To talk a little bit about that, residential remodeling now is more complicated than it's ever, ever been. There's HVAC systems, home automation, LED lighting, permitting, different engineering. All of this stuff is like a big thing that someone has to be able to talk intelligently about. And our partners call us because we know how to. So make sure, if it's us or whoever, that they know these things before you call them and get them in front of a client and they're fumbling through what their answers are. We've seen just about every scenario you can imagine. I'm going to sort of shift into the extreme and I'll get that over with, and then we'll talk about some other stuff. Has anyone seen that show? You guys know what I'm talking about? So I started with a show many years ago, and I've done pretty much anything you can imagine. I've blown houses up on demo day, driven trucks through them, built recent slides from a third story bedroom down to a basement for somebody in a house. I mean, really cool stuff, but what it's done for us is we sort of have this education that no one else has, and it's kind of a cool thing. So I want to give you some quick facts about extreme makeover builds. We would typically have 3 weeks of prep to build a 3,000 to 5,000 square foot house. So if you think about that in your mind, it's just totally crazy. I would land wherever I was in Salt Lake City or wherever it was and meet the builder who had no idea how to do this. We'd have 3 weeks before we started to get the whole thing together. The build time was 120 hours from start to finish. So, a lot of... They'd sort of roll out the red carpet as far as that goes. We would get like kind of immediate access to permitting and stuff like that. And it was all because this was charity and it wasn't, you know. But everyone says you build a house in 7 days, we built a house in 5 days. So the first day was camera, the last day was camera. We only had really had 5 days to do this. Usually involved at least 50 different subcontractor companies. And I can tell you, this is another presentation of how all this got organized, but it's pretty crazy. Up to 50 different vendors and suppliers. And by the way, everyone thought, or thinks, I think some people think, that that was all purchased by a check from ABC. The communities that we worked in donated everything that you saw on TV, which was pretty cool. That unfortunately was my job to get that for free, which was kind of tough. 24/7 construction schedule, obviously. Approximately 500 trade volunteers. That would be the electricians, HVAC, you name it, plumbers. And 4,000 general volunteers. So for project management, this is about as extreme as it gets. So we call it control chaos. But when everyone asks me how on earth we did it every time, there's only one time we failed. We were 2 days late, and it was because it was in Baltimore. We actually had you guys remember that there was like an earthquake? And so it shut us down. We couldn't work for a day, and et cetera. But this one right here is how these houses got built. If we needed the entire lumber package to get moved from one side of the lot to the other, I could just call on the radio and get 300 people to do it, and that's done in 5 minutes. I mean, this stuff just does not happen in the real world, but it did on the show, which was kind of cool. This is a video you probably want to see.
Frank to the rescue.
Yeah. We also had 24, one more bullet here. This was my tough job. The building inspector inspectors always wanted to be there, so they were there 24/7. And the way we had to work, they literally had to inspect as we were going. So everyone was like, there's no way you could have done that to code. Believe me, it was done to code. Here's a quick video. This video was at our 100th show. We did 200, or 100th home. We did 200 homes. This is really quick, don't worry. But this will kind of give you an idea of how we change people's lives, which is pretty cool.
Let's make it happen. Are you with me? Yeah! One, let's do it! One, no defense! One!
people in this country that fought down for this country.
We aren't heroes. We're here today as angels.
Every now and then in life, you have things that are truly defining moments.
We're going to build this house. We're going to change their lives. And let's build it with a heck of a lot of love.
We don't do the impossible this week.
We will succeed.
We're not just building a house for its family, we are rebuilding our dreams.
And to think that you've done 100 of these, my hat's off to all of our builders and to all the communities we've been in.
People often doubt that we can build a house in 7 days. Well, we do. We have helped 100 families. 100 families. You just have to believe.
Here we go! Here comes the first time!
This is what family and community is about. This is what America is about. And it gives you hope that if something ever goes wrong with you or your family, that there's people out there that will help.
You've given my family something that I could never do. And for that, I will always be grateful.
I had a dream come true. And we've been dreaming for a long time.
Thank you just for giving us our life back.
Let's get it together.
So if I was late, trust me, I heard it. I mean, it was bad. But in this job in particular, you can see what I just described, we were drywalling in the basement. So that's how it happened, is that we vertically built. Instead of building the whole structure and then working the inside totally, we worked floor to floor. And I had project managers in each room responsible for each room, and then I was controlling them sort of in general. So it's amazing when you get a ton of people working together what you can accomplish. This is a pretty complicated house. This is actually my favorite family. But the this got done, and we actually were about 3 hours, I think, ahead of time on this build. So it's kind of cool. Okay. So now, we'll just get to the kind of questions that your clients would ask you about a remodel. And this is really relevant to you. This is what they ask us. This is what they're going to ask you. Do we have the time and experience to manage every detail of a remodel? Chances are, the client's probably going to say yes, because of shows like Extreme or DIY or whatever it is. But there's so many things involved in a remodel. There's permitting, selections, budgeting, you name it that is involved in a remodel. You really need one person, one company in charge of doing, sort of handling all of that under one envelope. Of course, the solution is to seek an advocate. Before I go any farther, is there any architects in this room? All right, good. So the goal, obviously, if you have one company or whoever it is handling the project and is responsible for every aspect of it, it's going to be much more successful. Do we want a design build remodeler, or should we hire an architect? So this is the main question people ask, right? How do I get started? What do I do? There's basically two ways to do it. There's a design build firm that handles everything, or there's an architect that sends stuff out for RFP. Request for proposals. So they send out proposals after they've designed. We at Bowen and a lot of other design build firms, and there's a lot of great ones in this area, do the team approach. It's a design build firm, meaning that we are responsible for designing and building. That means why my designer, we have architects on staff, a lot of others do too, why they're designing, I'm also budgeting at the same time so that these things equal. If you think of a pendulum, if one is way off, it's not gonna work. You're gonna get inherently problems. And there's some other stuff that you can go through. We know things about permitting and other things that we have to sort of manage all together. The other approach is they hire an architect. So the architect would meet with them for, you know, depending on what size remodel it is, it could be a month, it could be 3 months. Our time is typically, 3 to 5 months of design procurement to get to where we started a job. This is a good approach if you want to compare pricing, but what's sort of the inherent problem with this is that the architect's talking about design with them for 2 to 3 months and then sending it out to bid. 2 to 3 months, you have no pricing. So for us, that's a huge problem. For a lot of our clients, that's a huge problem. However, there is architects that know a lot about pricing, that know and can kind of judge where they're designing. But there's nothing worse if you send out an RFP and you get 5 prices back and you're $300,000 more than you thought you wanted to spend. So there's the potential of this happening. You can always get a cheap price for anything, as you guys all know. I mean, there's always somebody who can do something cheaper. But clients end up paying for it in the long run, sometimes. We do hire architects. I mean, we have architects in-house. We have a lot of architect partners. The difference is, when we hire an architect, they work for me. They don't work for the client. That way, I can control what they're designing and what the overall budget will end up. We think homeowners benefit from the team approach, whether it's an architect that works for us, or whether it's in-house, or for any other company that you would be talking to. Is this team the right fit for our project and family? So, what's your guys' sales sort of cycle is? 1 to 2, 3 months, as far as when you meet a client until it closes. So, So in our world, it's usually 3 to 5 months of design, we're talking big projects in general here. It could be two, it could be one, but then up to 5 months to a year of construction. It's a lot of time being with somebody. So make sure that your remodeler that you're recommending has a record of being able to communicate and deal with people. If it's a kitchen remodel that they want to do, don't get an exterior contractor to come in and talk to him about doing a kitchen, because it's just going to fall back on you guys for referring them. They don't know how to do that.
A quick comment about that. Because you're working with so many different buyers that have so many different situations, it may be that, you know, one-stop shop is not the right thing. And an example of that would be if you're working with a seller and they want to do some cosmetic fixes to get the house ready. Well, clearly you're not going to call a design build firm because that's too much firepower for that project. But you may call a design build firm to get a good reference. And that's part of what we do, is kind of understand the game you're in. You know, if you say, Steve, the house is great, but they need a kitchen. They don't want to move anything. They just need countertops and things like that. Well, we open up our Rolodex and we say, here's a couple folks that, you know, you can give a call to. It's really important that the scope of work's sophistication match the sophistication of the company you refer. Because, you know, you may refer somebody who's not up to the job. You know, there's a lot of good kitchen and bath companies that just replace kitchens and baths. But if you send them a referral for an addition, it's probably not going to end well, and that might reflect poorly on you. So just, you know, be careful with that.
Yeah. And there's different size projects that deserve different size remodels. And I mean, I'll speak for myself. I refer more business out. When leads come in, I refer more out than I end up going on. And that's, I don't want them, if the project's not right for us, I want to guide them in the right direction. And that's obviously, you know, something you guys would do too. Do your homework, of course. Who's the right company? Is there a communication style with the person who's meeting the client? I'll tell a quick story. I have a lot of realtor partners, as I mentioned, where I work in Middleburg. And there was a big project or big sale that was sort of pending. They were in an exploratory time frame. And it was a $7.5 million cash deal. They had 2 weeks to explore remodels. So my partner called me and said, look, you got to come talk to these folks. The reason, I'm not saying, oh, great, Tim gets to do that. It's the reason that I'm bringing this up is that each situation is going to sort of give the opportunity for you to get somebody in front of that buyer. If it's the wrong person, I mean, I was really sort of thrilled that the guy called me. I'm like, wow, that's kind of, he's got some good confidence in me. This thing's going through as long as I perform. But that's what you need to make sure that happens. When you call a remodeler in, they can make or break the sale for you. Are they able to have tailored solutions? Are they able to get creative? Anyone can say, yeah, we'll just remodel this, it's gonna be this much. But when you come up with other solutions about what things can be done potentially, that builds value in the remodeler, builds value in you as the realtor. And then they're part of your family, as we discussed, of course. When do we know the design is right and the project is ready to start? Again, this is from homeowners. We have a saying at BOA that paper is cheap, and it's not that we like to waste a bunch of time designing, but everyone thinks this production schedule, or of production schedules, as the first spade hits the ground until they hand over the keys. But in reality, with remodeling, because remodeling is different, we're dealing with existing conditions. The most important part of it is from the signing of the design contract until you start. That's when you do all the designing, the budgeting, the selections, the permitting, the engineering. There's so much stuff to do. What typically happens in our industry, unfortunately, is half that stuff gets skipped, and then they go right into production, and then find a nested, oh my God, what is this? What do we find? We spend a lot of time in the upfront part. Our production, for that reason, is pretty smooth. I mean, remodeling inherently causes problems, and we find stuff all the time that we, oh my God, I didn't know that was there. But when you spend more time upfront, looking for the unknown, it makes a much better process. Obviously, make critical decisions long before you start the job. Smoother, more efficient construction process. How will your job be run? So this is something that I get, just because of stuff I've done, I get calls from a lot of my friends. I was hoping someone would be here tonight, and some of them would call me and do this kind of stuff. But the call always is, hey, I got this guy that sort of knows how about cabinetry, and I'm thinking about doing this rear addition. Do you think it would be okay if he handled sort of, you know, getting the foundation in and the floor and the framing, and then he'll do his thing? I'm saving like $30,000. I tell the same thing to them every time. Sometimes they listen to me, sometimes they don't. There needs to be someone on a remodeling job that's number one task is to bring that project in on time, on budget, with a happy client. If they're responsible for other stuff, and then maybe you're trying to help manage it, 9 times out of 10, that's going to come into, it's going to cause problems in the build. We, for instance, and there's a lot of others that do it, but we're a little bit more expensive than other firms because we have full-time project management from the day we start till the day we finish. Clean and safe job site, that's obvious. You know, you don't want to leave the job in a mess. Make sure that the person you're recommending cleans up every night. Consider the neighbors, that's a huge thing. Steve, I don't know if you want to talk about that, but you know, we go and knock on neighbors' doors around and give them a all kinds of crazy stuff happens. It just happens. Dump over and dump sewage through the neighbor's yard. So I guess we'd call it first. I just didn't even know what I was going to do with that. But we got it solved really quick. That guy's giving me 2 leads now. The neighbor, not even the client, the neighbor. So, you know, taking the extra time to consider these things is really important. Projects over budget, my project's over schedule, or the model doesn't perform. All of these things tend to happen in our business in general. If you sort of follow these things that we've talked about before, the chances of this stuff happening are less and less. People always decide when we're in a build, hey, I might want to do this, and you have to sort of like work through that process. But if you follow the processes and steps, or your modeler does, the chances of this stuff happening are less and less. The bottom one is something that's also kind of important and leads us to kind of our last question here, is when you refer a remodeler, make sure that they have a track record of following up after you're done. Just like probably the big builders, I don't know if you came in here before, whoever it was, me or all those guys, that they have a customer service division. And the reason they have that is they know stuff's going to go wrong. I mean, houses move and expand and contract with the climate. Stuff's going to go wrong, so who do they call? Remodelers sometimes go from one job to the next, and sort of forget about what's happening afterwards. Post-project service for us is a huge lead source. We'll go and fix something, next thing you know, we're doing another project for them because our guys are really good at sort of fixing stuff and talking to them and taking care of stuff efficiently. So make sure that the remodeler you're recommending has a warranty, number one, and that it's listed on their contract, who they call for, make sure your client knows who to call for service calls, etc. This may be what a lot of you guys are waiting for. I'm sort of shifting now to cost value for remodeling projects. This is from Remodeling Magazine. Is anyone familiar with that magazine? So that magazine is really sort of in the forefront of doing cost value analysis. And this, they can get this, I'm sure, from you guys if you need this. They divide this up into different divisions. I'll tell you that first here. So we are considered the South Atlantic division or region. That spans from Baltimore to Florida. So obviously, jobs in DC area and jobs in Florida are going to be different costs. So that sort of averages out here. So the numbers, you know, you can kind of look at them. What is important is this cost recouped, because that's where you'll see an indicator. The arrows are actually from the change from 2015, so that's a year change if they've gone up and down. If you look here, it's the classic stuff that you guys as realtors know. Any sort of fixing up of the front of the house is an immediate return. Attic insulation is 130% return, totally crazy. backup generators, you drop down to 64, basement remodel 73, bathroom 57, bathroom remodel 70, decks 69, 80% for a wood deck, the difference between composite. Front door replacement, 82%. The thing that's important to look at with this chart is that a lot of people think when they remodel, the ratio is at least 1:1. It's not. If I was giving this presentation in 2003, which I'm dating myself, I did, everyone loved me because I was like, wow, look, kitchen, 130% return. I mean, everything was a huge return. It's not that case anymore, and I don't think we're going to see that. Remodeling, again, is sort of a personal buy for people, okay? They want to, if they're going to stay in the house for a long time, it makes a lot of sense. If they're going to leave or flip, it doesn't make sense. It's more, it makes more sense to do sort of a cosmetic remodel. And here's a continued entry door replacement, obviously 98%. Family room addition, 68. You can kind of read your garage door, 97. All of the sort of fixer-upper things on the front of the house make a big return for the buyer. All of this stuff, though, makes you different from your neighbor when they're trying to sell, and that maybe is what's the most important thing for you guys.
And just having this chart, and Genevieve will share it with you if you like, that would be helpful when you're trying to win a listing. You know, you can say, could I suggest to you, Mr. and Mrs. Jones, that we replace the garage door and the front door, that it's almost 100% return on investment. You know, and you come across as an expert and you leave in that document, and you know, it's, again, that knowledge piece that we're trying to provide.
I will say, in this area, it tends to be a little higher than what is listed here. I mean, we're in one of the hottest markets for remodeling and probably real estate, I would guess, compared to, like, Central Florida. So, I mean, you have to kind of put that in perspective here. We look at indicators for this, sort of the upscale remodeling values. And if you look at these, a lot of them, except for this front door, right? Yeah, garage door replacements at 93. Most of this stuff is in the 50s and 70s. So our clients tend to buy things because they want it. They love where they live. They're going to be there for another 15, 20 years. They're going to recoup eventually, and they want it for the lifestyle. And that's a big thing to understand, that it's not all return one-to-one. It's not going to be that ratio. And again, we can send this to you. Sort of in conclusion, we have the late night top 10 tips of reasons projects fail. So you'll let you kind of go through this if you want.
Sure. What I'd like to say before we get to this, though, is that you know, there are ways that a remodeler can help you. We have, you know, programs to host brokers opens, and Janine back there, I just did a brokers open with her recently. And, you know, the first question is, why? You know, why would I do a brokers open? What's in it for me? I mean, you're sitting here going, Steve, how are you going to put dollars in my pocket? Well, if we know that more than 50% of the buyers are going to do a project in the first 90 days, and I can go to Janine's brokers open and get visiting agents fired up about the house and what it could be so that they're enthusiastic about bringing buyers back, and then those agents say, well, if you're going to do a renovation, you know, here's one person that you can call, or do I have your permission to have Steve call? I mean, you know, this isn't charity up here. You guys are selling houses. Those houses are getting remodeled. I'm in the remodeling business. You get it. So, you know, that's why we're doing it. And we're going to knock it out of the park for you, I can tell you that. So we're going to host brokers opens. And, you know, it's got to be the right house for us because we do work in the luxury market. But, you know, that said, what we're finding, especially in my territory, which is Oakton and Vienna, if typically, you know, where our old market used to be houses that were a million plus, what we're finding, and maybe you're finding this too, is we're finding folks that could afford a 1.1 or 1.2 house, but they're not buying that house. They're buying a $700,000 or an $800,000 house in a great neighborhood with great public schools, because they want to take that $200,000, $300,000, $400,000 and do their own remodeling.
And it goes back to, you know, nobody buys the perfect house. I've bought four houses in my life, and I've never bought the perfect house. But I wasn't looking for the perfect house because the business I'm in, clients aren't doing that anymore. They're having fun remodeling their house. So I think it opens up the market for you a little bit, and it opens up the market for us as well.
Yeah, I think it's important that this isn't a bonus sales thing. I mean, there's different remodelers, as Steve said, for every project. But we'd love if you need to contact us, we have resources that we can connect you with anybody that's perfect for that job. Again, here's sort of the top 10 list. Your clients don't hire a guy or advocate. Bad processes, of course. Poor design guidance. This is somewhat important. You know, we're a design build firm. If our designers suck, it's not going to be good. I mean, that's just what it's going to come down to. So we spend a lot of time training them and working them with our different design aspects and what's sort of hot now and what people are buying. Unrealistic budgets, both client and remodeler budgets. So, and that's important. A lot of client budgets are unrealistic for even purchasing homes, right? But a lot of remodelers don't know their cost either. So they'll say, yeah, we can do that, and then they get halfway through it, and oh gosh, it's gonna cost this much, so make sure that that's not the case. Incomplete construction preparation, of course. What can be done before you list the property, and other remodelers can help you with that as well. Home open house sponsorships, home inspection report analysis, ease the fear of renovation.
Can I just touch on that home inspection report? Has anybody in the room ever got a home inspection report that was 30 pages long and scary and the buyer was freaking out? A lot of head nods, okay. Well, let's not blame the home inspection folks, because they have a job to do and they do it really well, and their job is to check everything and, you know, check their boxes. But for somebody who's not in the renovation business, which is, you know, 98% of the world, that can be scary and it can squash the deal. So for our renovation partners, you know, folks that we have a relationship with, and I just had one of these, Donna, I can never get her last name right, so I'm going to try and swing at it. Called up and said, Steve, I'm selling this $900,000 home in Great Falls, and we just got the inspection report, and my buyer is freaking out. He wants to back out. And I said, send it to me, and I'll look at it. You know, and it's 30 pages, and it's thick. And I just went through it, and I put a dollar sign next to it, what a handyman company that I trust would asked to make these things. Well, it was $21,000 in repair. $21,000 is a lot of money, but it's not a lot of money compared to the 1.4 or 900,000. So, you know, this guy's fear level went from a 10 to a 2. And the seller was happy to give him $21,000 or 16, I forget, they negotiated it. But again, you know, these are the kind of things you're gonna run into, and if you have a good renovation partner, and again, if it's not BOA, it's somebody else, but you should be asking these things of the people that you're bringing clients to, is, hey, I need you to review this for me so we don't squash this deal. I mean, you know, you're in a very powerful position as a realtor, and you know, you need to swing that stick once in a while, you know, in a good way with the folks you're working with.
And 9 times out of 10, Steve mentioned, 9 times out of 10, they like, this plug's not working. I mean, that stuff, when you read it, it's sort of scary, but it's usually small stuff. It really is. we look for stuff like structural defects where they're going to be spending hundreds of thousands of dollars back. And there are some out there like that. But the sort of whole motivation with this is that we hope that this moves the needle for you all on one house that you may think, well, there's no one that's going to buy this. But so if you approach it a different aspect of, hey, maybe you looked at the end amount of what you're going to spend. Here's what it's going to cost to purchase it. Here's what it's going to cost to remodel it. It could change it and maybe get one or two more sales for you, which hopefully that's what will happen. So thank you. Any questions that you guys have? Yeah, sure.
Thank you. That was very great presentation. I have seen a lot of remodeling that went really bad in expensive homes.
Yeah.
And then you have a hard time to sell it.
Mm-hmm.
Because the basement they finished is just...
doesn't fit the other two levels.
It doesn't. So it's very important to go with good company, a good design that they can finish all the stuff is finished. That's not just a remodeling.
And these relationships with, it's just like, we spend a lot of time developing realtor relationships. It's not like they call me, I want to discuss how you guys work, whatever, with whoever it is, and make sure that you're doing that. You've seen these people, how they react to stuff when it goes wrong. That's really the most important thing, is how they have to react when it goes wrong.
Yeah, exactly.
And sometimes that's your best thing.
That's easy.
Yeah.
Is that true? Because I can see a lot of people buy the houses and they want to remodel it and install. So there can be act like a contractor when going to do the permits. But hire a handyman to do the basements or things like that and not by the code. When they want to sell it, they need to hire somebody like you to put it by the code because it's not even going to be accepted.
So to piggyback on that. So if I go to a purchase console and there's a pool there, I almost always know there's an open permit. And I bet about 9 times out of 10 there's an open permit. Pool guys don't find all that any of their stuff. So what's going to happen if that happens, right? The new buyer is responsible for that. So that could kill your deal. So those type of things, I mean, you have to really make sure who you're working with is a professional who can handle that.
Do we have other questions?
Hi, I'm Mona. Two questions. If you have a savvy buyer, someone who maybe has a family member that can help with design or a family member that's an architect, will you guys work with an outside architect or not?
Yeah, we will work with an outside architect. Our business model is typically one-stop shop. You know, we do it all, with the exception of architects. We'll work with outside architects. Now, if a homeowner said, I want you guys to do everything except my brother-in-law is a plumber, that's not going to work. Water in a house, and I don't know this guy? No way. No way. But thank you for that question. What's your second question?
My second question, do you guys do bump outs too? Like
pop tops,
yeah. Sorry.
Yeah. Yeah, we should just take a second to kind of like put a little frame around BOA. So we're a large company by remodeling standards. Last year, $30 million, 65 employees. We've done almost $500 million worth of business in 28 years. Never been to court, never been sued in a litigious society where more than half of our clients are attorneys. That's not to say we haven't had issues, but we solve them at the kitchen table, not at court. We work in Northwest DC primarily, in Maryland primarily, it's Montgomery County, in Northern Virginia, the usual suspects, Arlington, McLean, Great Falls, started to do a lot of business in Oakton and Fairfax, Vienna. Tim handles Hunt Country, so that's Middleburg, Upperville, Upper Crust. but again, you know, we're a lot of firepower. You know, we're not for every project. and that's okay. We don't want to do every project. We want to be the right client or the right contractor for the right situation. And as Tim said, we refer a lot of work out more than we take in because, we say to people, you don't need BOA. This is a pull and replace kitchen and you're getting ready to sell your home. Let me line you up with somebody where you can spend a little more money. It's going to work for you. And all that does is, create a fan. I mean, we're giving good advice. There's so much overlap to our business and your business. It's a trust business. It's a people business. You're as good as your word. You're as good as your last deal. I mean, there's a lot on the line. Folks are making the biggest purchase of their life. You better get it right. And they're going to spend a ton of money on that house, and we have to get it right. So again, that's why this relationship is so important. Again, whether it's with BOA or somebody else, if you get the right little guy, little contractor who's going to do the little stuff for your sellers, and you get the right big guy who's going to do the big projects, you're going to see your business take off. I promise you, I've seen it so many times.
And to mention that, so for the larger remodelers, there's we think we're the best, but there's a couple others in the area. There's quite a few. And the larger firms are usually good with projects 700,000 and above house values. The ones that are less than that, it depends. We sort of have a Rolodex of people that we refer. They can usually handle smaller type projects. We have a 70, 40, 50, 60, $70,000 kitchen sort of changeovers that where you're not really doing a lot of other things. We're not right for that, but we know people that are. We do, just to answer your question about the architect, so we do, architects do come to us with plans, even though we're design build, and say, hey, I have a client that wants guys to explore a price of job for them. We just hire that different. We do that differently in the upfront part of it. We do it as a T&M thing because we're not spending a ton of time, going down research projects that aren't going to go anywhere. And we hire architects under us as well as from the very start. So it really just depends on if someone has somebody that they really like and they use, we're happy to talk to them. Most remodelers are.
I have a question back here, actually.
Hi, Michelle. I have a question about permits. What's the question? Oh, yeah. The question is, so a buyer, they've got a basement that hasn't been remodeled. Do they have to get a permit if they want to add a bathroom, if they want to do some changes inside the basement? The next question on permits is, have a buyer who's looking at a house and the kitchen didn't have a permit, what's the problem they're going to have buying that house unpermitted?
Okay, great questions. And I had these in my pocket. I told Genevieve and Frank, if they don't ask certain questions, I'll ask for them because, we know what's being asked out there. So the first thing with permits, this is an easy one. It's easy. If you're adding plumbing or moving plumbing, if you're adding electric or moving electric or any structure, deck, putting in a new window that isn't there, a bigger door, you need a permit. Super simple. Now, if there's a window there and you put a new window in, you're not changing the size, there's no structure involved. But adding plumbing, adding electric, moving electric, it's a permit. And to your second question, if you don't get a permit, that's going to get found out at some point, and it's going to goof up the sale. Now, there are a few innocent homeowners who somehow buy a house and it's got non-permitted work that's going on, and it gets through the sale. But, I would think that would be on your questionnaire when you're meeting somebody who's listing, and you say, have there been any remodeling projects here? Is everything permitted? Do you know if you have any open permits in Fairfax or Arlington County, wherever you're working? I mean, those are questions they're not going to get from the other realtors they're interviewing. And so when they hear that from you, they're going to say, wow, this person really cares about me. They really don't want to see bad things happen to me during this process. So did I answer the second question? I'm not even sure I did. Was it about a basement? Yeah. getting old. Thanks. Yeah, go ahead.
My name is Greg, and last week I represented a group of investors. We put a bid on a house that was full of black mold. From your experience, how problematic is black mold?
Very problematic. There's a whole abatement process. It depends on how extreme it's gotten.
Everywhere.
Yeah. Is it in the wood, or is it just surface mold?
It's on every drywall room that we can see.
So it tends to grow on the stuff like drywall glue and paper and things like that. But what will happen is it will get in cavities and literally just start growing throughout the house. There is a way to abate it. We could do that. Like, I'm a certified lead remover. I don't do that. I hire somebody to do it, and then that's what I recommend, because then they test it afterwards. To get an idea, you know, you have to get them out there and say, hey, how much is this gonna cost? Black mold's a huge issue now. People see that, they run. I mean, they really do. But sometimes you can bait it and get rid of it, and it's not as big a deal as people think. It all depends on what the scenario is. And
a lot of it has to do with the timing. You know, like if the house got wet and mold can appear in 7 to 10 days, but you're there on day 14 and it's all over the drywall, and you pull the drywall down and it's not on the 2x4s behind, that's when it gets into trouble. As Tim said, it's behind the drywall now, it's actually inside the wood, and now it's going up towards the roof. That's when it gets to be an issue.
And like a chipboard, you'll see it'll grow and that kind of stuff. If it's all glue and adhesive, it takes off.
I had a question about flippers. When we're working with buyers and we're looking at a home that's been remodeled, probably like a flipper, are there some signs we should look for or things we should do? What questions should we ask to find out if things were done properly? There was something in the Coast recently about some couple that were doing flippings, and it was a huge
DC
problem.
The number one thing is check with permanent office. Nine times out of 10, they're not pulling permits, and that's going to become an issue right away. And then get an analysis of the stuff that's been done. I mean, unfortunately, that's like a home inspection or whatever. But I've seen houses that have been flipped that have been done really well and not got a permit. And then I've just come in and part of our sort of agreement to do the remodel was to piggyback that permit and get it finaled out. So it just, you know, each thing is different, but I would check with the permit office first. It's probably your best bet.
Yeah, and that's a simple phone call. It's 5 minutes, literally, to say, you know, I'm a realtor in Northern Virginia. I'm doing some research for a client of mine. Could you look up the property? Here's the address. Boom, boom, boom. Are there any open permits? I mean, literally, it's going to take you 2 minutes. And that's great information.
Yeah. And by the way, don't totally freak out about the open permits thing. So, back where I do business, there's a lot of open permits. People start jobs and they never final it out, and the houses go for sale. And these are big estates, right? The good people, good remodelers have relationships. They work with the building department. They know the building department. When we take over a job, I go and meet with the building department and say, hey, here's what is not permitted. I piggyback it on my new permit, and then we become obviously responsible taking care of that stuff. But there's ways to do that. What you want to make sure is you don't have shoddy work, because that's something you can't really, it's all liability issues.
Does anybody else have it?
Yeah.
So for example, you did a finished basement. Is the homeowner for the permit, or is you guys for the permit?
You can do it either way. We pull the permit. We always pull the permit. If it's our drawing, we want to be responsible for the permit.
But I mean, a homeowner can pull a demolition permit, certainly. Demolition.
You need to finish the whole basement, add a bathroom.
The homeowner can do that. So let's say in that case, the homeowner wants to be the general contractor. So you would go down to the permit office. You're going to need a set of plans. If there's structure, it's going to need an engineering stamp. You show the plan, you get approved for a permit. You're still going to need a licensed electrician, a licensed plumber, if there's a bathroom down there, that are going to pull permits off of your homeowner's permit. You're going to be the general contractor for a major renovation in your house. Your hair is black now. It's not going to be black.
But check the municipalities, because I know some counties around here that don't require that. And the homeowner can do their own electrical plumbing, which gets somewhat scary.
Can I ask Can I go back to that question about when a buyer says to you, "I love the house, but I don't like the kitchen. What's a kitchen cost?" And you know, I may have sounded like a wise guy when I said, "Well, what's a car cost?" And you know, it stuns them. They're like, well, you know, they don't get it. And they say, well, "What's a car? What car?" You know, and you say, "Well, what kitchen? Is it a Camry? Is it a, you know, whatever the car is that you want to use?" But you know, have the modest, the medium, and the depending on the neighborhood. But then you can't just stop there because that's not very helpful. You say, "Well, you know, Mrs. Jones, there's two things that really drive a budget on any remodeling project. One is the scope of work. What are we doing and how complicated is it? And the other is the level of finish. So when you say to me, how much is a kitchen? I can say, well, if we don't move anything, you know, if that window stays there and the sink is still under the window and the appliances are still where they are and we're just doing a pull and replace, then, you know, that's a more modest approach. If we're taking the wall down between the kitchen and the dining room, which is going to be a structural repair and we're going to be doing beams in the ceiling, and that's also going to affect the floor because if we're taking the wall away, there's going to be a hole in the hardwood and the knee bone's connected to the shin bone, and you know where I'm going on this. What's the scope of work? I don't know. And then as far as the level of finish goes, that's selections. Is it a $10,000 appliance package we're talking about for this kitchen? Is it a $40,000 appliance package? I don't know, because I don't know what an appliance package looks like. But I've done projects, you know, everywhere in between. So you provide a little information, and then you slowly step away from that tricky question.
Well, they have to answer these things. I mean, it's using the same footprint we've done. Just to give an example, in the past I've done kitchens for $100,000, I've done them for $400,000. Same exact stuff, same exact layout. The cabinets were $20,000 on one job, or whatever, and they were $110,000 on another. Exact same layout. So it's hard to answer that question. You have to really sort of educate your buyer.
One more question, so y'all can go enjoy networking and speaking with Green out there. And Ramona has one, and then this gentleman.
Oh, sorry, I have a quick question. Let's say I have a house that I've listed, and I know that the kitchen needs some upgrading, the bathroom, it's a house from the late 80s. But the sellers don't want to do those updates, so we've priced it. Would you guys be able to put together like a one-sheeter and like specify this kind of cabinet, this kind of countertop would cost this much, so we could put it with the flyers? Is that something you guys would do? So that when people come in, they could know.
Sounds like. I mean, let's have that conversation. I don't want to say no to anything. But I know what you're looking for, and I'm just trying to think of like, how can I give you what you want and not have it be a one-off, but like give you documents that you can have that will be helpful to you. So kind of like that, the renovation documents.
My name is Ahmad. I just had a really quick question. Do you guys work with a lot of investors or other people that are flipping the building? Or
we do not. And, okay. And the reason for that is we're kind of providing an experience. Uh-huh. And the experience is, you know, if it's not Nordstrom's, I don't know what it is, but it's white glove, blow them away with design, blow them away with our selections, blow them away with production and communication and aftercare. And having done some of that work myself, investor who wants to buy it as cheap as he can. I mean, my partner and I used to say, if it doesn't have pigeon poop on the floor, we're not looking at it. I mean, it has to be a dump, has to be in a good neighborhood. And we want to pay as little as possible to get it to market as fast as possible. That's the total opposite of what we're doing.
Makes sense.
Yep. He didn't say
anything. Hey, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for the great
fantastic.
Thanks for the great questions. Appreciate it. Thank you.
And I can tell you that some of the remodeling they have done without permit, I have seen it that the county comes and destroys it, demolish it. It happened to some son-in-law and some room on the back and they demolished. That happens. So getting extra.